My name is Eddie Pascal. We're doing a documentary on my trips and my time in the Merchant Marine during the Second World War. I was born on January 25th, 1927, in Coney Island, by the sea. And in the spring of 1944, I was 17 years old, and the war was on at that time, Second World War, and I decided I would go into the Merchant Marine. In order to go into the Merchant Marine, I had to either go to a training school or get experience on the harbor. I chose the harbor because I could be making money while I was training. And I went to work on tugboats and dredges to get my experience as a seaman. And we dredged, we towed barges, we did all the different kinds of harbor work around New York. And with 90 days of work on the harbor, I was able to go to the Coast Guard and secure my seaman's papers. I got my seaman's papers, and with that I went to the Union Hall on 105 Broad Street in Manhattan. Signed up there, they gave me a card, put me on the list, the waiting list, for a ship. And that's how I started my sailing career, right at that point.
And your love will kindle the flame. What a sweet beginning.
Okay, well, I'd like to mention that Bob Kowalski was on this trip with me. I knew the Kowalski family, and they lived in Sheepshead Bay, and I lived in Coney Island. And we grew up knowing each other as kids, playing in the sand lots and everything. He was a little older than me, so he was able to get a job on a tugboat. He went to work for Arundel, dredging and towing, and then with that he got his seaman's papers and he shipped out to South America and back to New York. It was a short trip, like about a month or so. Meanwhile, I got a job with Great Lakes Dredging and Towing. I got my seaman's papers after that, and we both got together one day, and then he was going up to the Union Hall, and he introduced me to the idea, and we went together to the Union Hall. And we signed up our card to register for a trip. So then you had 30 days to ship. If your card was new, you threw in for a job, you probably wouldn't get it. But once it was 15 or 20 days old, then we call that a ripe card. It was good and ripe and ready to go. Then if you liked the trip that was on the board, then you threw in for it, and if you were lucky, you got it. So when we threw in for the ship together, and we got on the same ship, that's how we got on the same ship. We were at the Union Hall together, and we threw in for it. So the first ship I got assigned to was the John G. Carlisle, which was a Liberty ship. The Liberty ship has five hatches, and it was built to carry cargo. And it was lots of them made, and they weren't very fast, but they did the job. That was a big thing during the war. The Liberty ship was a big help to winning the war because it carried all the supplies and everything everywhere we were fighting. Okay, so we boarded the ship in New York around December 2nd, and we moved it to Hawkins Point, Baltimore, which was an ammunition pier. The trains came in there, brought the ammunition to the pier, then they loaded it onto the ships that were on both sides of the pier. We loaded 7,500 tons of 105 howitzer shells. And after the ship was loaded, Then we moved out to off the coast and joined the convoy. The convoy was 100 cargo ships bound for the Mediterranean. So we sailed the South Atlantic in convoy with destroyer escort. When we were sailing on this Liberty ship, and the food was great, and the cooks were nice. In fact, the chief cook in the galley was an Italian guy. And I was really surprised because they never made spaghetti. Spaghetti was always a side dish, you know, like another vegetable. You had potatoes, you had corn, and you had spaghetti. And whatever you had, spaghetti was always included here and there as a small portion. But it was not good at all, so I complained about it. And the cook said to me, well, if you think you can do better, then I'll let you come in the galley and you can cook the spaghetti. So he tempted me with that, so I called him on it and I said, okay, I'll do that. So I went into the galley one day and I set it all up, and I was in charge of the whole galley, and I told everybody what to do: get the pot ready, fill it up with water, get it boiling, get the spaghetti, make the sauce. We put the sauce together, meatballs and sausage, you know, the whole schmear. We had grated cheese handy, and when we served the spaghetti, we didn't serve it like a side dish. We served it like a main dish, you know, a big bowl with lots of spaghetti and sausage and meatball and cheese, grated cheese on it. And we served it that way, and they ate the whole thing up. And the other food that was still prepared was, you know, like meat and potatoes and that kind of thing, like they usually had. So anyway, it was a big success. Everybody really loved it. And that put me on the map and made me famous on the trip, because I was the youngest guy on the ship. I was only 17 years old at the time. You think about that. And it was a lot of fun being in the kitchen and putting out, telling everybody what to do. But that was the only time we ever did it, just that one day. And after that, when they made spaghetti, they were right back in their old habits again. The spaghetti was terrible. They only had good spaghetti that one time, and they talked about it for the whole trip. They wanted to have it more, but I wasn't allowed to go in the kitchen anymore. It couldn't get to be a habit, you know. So that was the story on that. It took us 15 days to get to Gibraltar. Once we entered the Mediterranean, the ships went in all different directions where they were supposed to go. And then we were supposed to tie up in Oran, Africa, but we tied up in the next door port right next door to it, which was called Mers El Kabar. And it was breakwaters that were built out of concrete. That was like a makeshift dock, because they had no piers there. So we had to build piers to accommodate the ships coming in and tie up there. We stayed there a total of 5 or 6 days. While we were docked, the destroyer escort used to ride around the harbor area and drop depth charges every half hour to make sure that no one was swimming out from the water, from the shore, to put a depth charge, put a charge onto the propeller to disable the ship. And so that was our first port in the Mediterranean. And we had to tie up there, and we had to wait for orders where to go and discharge our load of ammunition. So while we were there, we were able to go ashore. So there wasn't much to do, and there wasn't a town there at all. It was just all desert and just a couple of little villages. And of course, we were looking for some place where we could get a drink. We did get into what looked like a little town, and there was some stores and different little shops, And there was a place where we could go in and somebody was providing you could have a drink, you know. It was like a makeshift little bar. And so it wasn't much to see or do there. And what they had to drink, I don't know if I remember, but they had some wine, they had some vodka, and that's about it. They were very limited in what they had to drink. They didn't drink much alcohol there. But they wanted to trade cigarettes. They could buy cigarettes cheap and then sell them for a little more. That's what they really were looking for, cigarettes, you know. So we started drinking in some place, and then when we came back, we had a truck brought us there, and then we got back onto the truck and rode back to where the ship was docked. And they had a big fence around the area, and it was locked up so that nobody could come in there that wasn't allowed in there. When we pulled up to the gate and the truck stopped, and then we had to get off the truck. But because there was a light shining and it looked like the back of the truck went further, and so one of the guys stepped off the truck and fell down onto the ground right in the mud that was there. The shadow made it look like the back of the truck was further on, and he went taking another step and he fell right off the end of the truck and into the mud. And that really made him angry. He was cursing away there. But what could you do? You know, it was an accident. So when we were getting off the truck, all these young Arab kids were begging us for money, for cigarettes, for whatever they, candy, chocolate. They were so hungry for stuff and they thought we had plenty of things with us. And so some of the fellows that had stuff, they gave away some cigarettes, they gave away some chocolate. And one of the guys, the kids were pestering him, and it annoyed him, and he pushed them away and said, "Get out of here, you little bastards," because the kid was saying he was begging for stuff, and he couldn't speak English very well, so he was saying, "No mommy, no poppy," and holding out his hand and begging for food or money or whatever. So he says to him, "No mommy, no poppy, get out of here, you little bastard." And the kids got mad at him then. And we all got inside the gate. Then he turned around. Once he was inside the gate, he went over by the fence and he started teasing them making fun of them or something, you know. And he got close to the fence, and the kids reached through the fence and grabbed a hold of him and pulled him towards the fence. And when he tried to reach his hands out and hit them, they grabbed his hands, and he tried to kick them, and they grabbed his feet. So they pulled his hands and his feet through the fence, and they had him all tied up like that. And while they had him tied up like that, they picked his pockets right through the fence. All their little hands were working on him. It was amazing. And whatever money he had on him or his watch and different things that he had, they picked him clean. Then they let him go and they ran away. And that was something to witness, because these little kids when he aggravated them, they got so mad they wanted to get even on him, you know, and that's what they did. So that was a very unusual thing to happen. And we never went ashore anymore. That was just that one time that night we went there, and it was dark, and we went by truck, and we came back to the gate and let us in, because there was no taxi cabs. There was no way to get into the town if not with an American truck, you know, somebody driving us. And that was how we went ashore. But we never did that anymore. And that wasn't a very nice place to go ashore anyway. There was nothing to do there. There was nothing to see. There was nothing. It was just barren, just desert area, and Arab families living out in the wilderness. And because the ship was in there, they came over there, and they were just begging, and see what they could get, a little money or cigarettes or whatever they could get to trade and make something. But you know, and that was our experience in Oran, Africa. We stayed there about a week, and they didn't take the ammunition off there because by this time the army had gone through Italy from North Africa and into southern France. So that's where they needed the ammunition. So they sent us we went to Algiers for orders, and we sailed across the Mediterranean to southern France and docked at Marseille. And because they didn't know what to do with us at the time or where we would go. And then we went to Port de Bouc, which is a small port in southern France, and that's where we discharged the ammunition. While we were docked at Port de Bouc, the ship was being unloaded by American GIs. These GIs were sleeping in pup tents on the dock. And it was cold because it was winter time. They slept with their clothes on, and they got up in the morning and came to work on, and there were two 10-hour shifts of GIs unloading the ammunition that we had on us. And most of them were young, 18, 19, 20 years old. In fact, one of the older guys was only 27 years old, and they used to call him Pappy. Now, while we were docked there, and the GIs were doing all this work, they were given the permission to come into the mess hall and have eggs, real eggs for breakfast instead of powdered eggs, and be inside the house where it was nice and warm. And so that really was a treat for them, and they really enjoyed that. They appreciated it. And when we finally were unloaded, when we were getting ready to leave, and we were letting go the lines, and the GIs were on the dock to take the eye off the bit and drop it in the water, and we were pulling the lines in, and they were all standing there, about 100 of them, and they were looking up at the ship, and we were looking down at them, and as we pulled in the lines and we backed away from the dock, it was very sad to see them all standing there, because they knew that they were stuck there and we were going back to New York, and that would be our next stop, and they would still be stuck there in France. When we left the dock and we left the Mediterranean, we went past Gibraltar. Now we're in the Atlantic Ocean, and we joined up with a convoy, which was also a lot of ships, at least 50 or 60 ships in the convoy. And the convoy was only traveling at like 8 knots, because we had to go as slow as the slowest ship in the convoy for them to keep up. And then we ran into some bad weather, and there were some huge waves, and because the Liberty ship we were on had no ballast, no weight, no cargo, we were sitting on top of the water like a big cork, and the propeller was constantly out of the water, because we were riding these huge waves. It was a big storm we were going through. And then at some point when we went up on one wave and came down so hard, we heard this huge crack sound, and the captain was concerned. So we slowed down the ship, because at number two hatch, the seam opened up from the main deck down to the keel on one side of the ship. A 2-inch crack appeared And so we could have split in half, but we didn't. And we had to slow down to like 3 or 4 knots to stop the pounding. Otherwise, we would break up altogether. And meanwhile, the convoy then went ahead of us. We fell back, and we wound up crossing the rest of the ocean alone, without any protection or any convoy. And when we got back to New York, and we finally were able to go, when we went down on the dock as we were walking off the ship, we were able to stand up close and see the crack and exactly what it looked like. It was a 2-inch crack all the way down to one side of the ship. And of course, a lot of water came into the number 2 hatch, but it didn't affect the ship as far as balance or whatever. But we had to travel very slowly, so we got back late. And that was the end of the first trip. When we finally got back, it was February 14th, and that was St. Valentine's Day. And that was my father's birthday, so he was very happy that we got home on his birthday, and that was a great thing for us, very 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 nice. Okay. All right. Well, I like to mention that Billy Aldridge was on this trip with me. Yeah. Well. We were neighbors, and we were friends. I knew him from the neighborhood. We lived in just a few blocks apart from one another, and we knew each other since we were very young, although we didn't go to the same elementary school together. And when he went to maritime training school and got his seaman's papers, and then we got together and we decided to go down to the Union Hall and ship out together. And that's how that happened. Not only was this my second trip, but it was Billy's second trip also. And the first trip we were on together. Now, Billy Aldridge went on his first trip, and he was on a seagoing tugboat that was towing something, and it was called an intercoastal trip. He didn't go overseas. He just went down south on the tugboat and back to New York. It was a short trip, and it was just intercoastal. It was a local thing. This was the only trip Billy and I made together. And after we made that second trip, then on my third trip, he wasn't with me, and he stayed home and actually got drafted into the Army. Because what happened to him was, when he got drafted into the Army, because he overstayed his leave, you were only allowed a certain amount of days, and when the draft would come up, whoever was available, they scooped him right up, and he got scooped up into the Army, and he wound up in the Army for I'm not sure how long, just a few months. And then the war was over, and they discharged him. My second trip started on May 13, 1945, on a T-2 tanker called the Chesapeake Capes. And it was docked in Staten Island, and it was loading gasoline. A T-2 tanker is a very large ship that carries 12,000 tons of fuel, either oil or gas, and they transport it across oceans. That's what a T-2 tanker is, and that's what a T-2 tanker does. When we left with this T-2 tanker, we joined a convoy, and we crossed the North Atlantic. And it was very foggy, because it usually is foggy in the North Atlantic, especially in the winter. In order to ride in convoy and not lose track of each other, each ship towed what they call a fog buoy, which was made out of wood and was towed on a long line, and you could see the spray shooting up from the water, and you could keep your eye on that fog buoy, even though you couldn't see the ship in your column in front of you. The British Museum. And that's how we crossed the North Atlantic that time. And there was no lights on showing on the ship. The ship's, all the lights were out in the convoy so that they couldn't be seen from submarines and things like that. Well, when we came into Swansea, Wales, it's a kind of a small place, and there was a one street that was bombed out, and the only thing that was standing on the block was a church. And the reason why the church was standing there was because the Germans came over on a bombing run, and one German plane was trying to get away from the English fighter planes. So he just started to run back across the channel, and he just dropped his bombs so that he could go a little faster. And when he dropped his bombs, the string of bombs, and right through Swansea and hit all the buildings and missed the church and left the church standing there. It was the only thing standing. And that was what happened there. Like when we unloaded the gasoline in Swansea, Wales, and we started back, we were still traveling in convoy. We met up with a bunch of ships in the English Channel, and we started back to New York. And they declared the end of the war while we were there. And so then all the ships were able to turn on their lights and travel alone without convoy. So for miles and miles, you could see ships out in the ocean with their lights on where you couldn't see them before. Because there were always blackout curtains and things like that. But now that the war was over, we were able to just forget about that and didn't have to worry about it. And each ship just took off in their own direction and at their own speed, so that the fast ones would go ahead and the slow ones would fall behind. But it was a whole ocean full of ships all lit up like Times Square. And that was the way that was. Except for the North Atlantic was very cold, and we had to watch out for icebergs coming back. Keep a sharp lookout for that. Because when you sail up like that northern circle, you're going further north, and it's colder and there's more icebergs, is what it is. On June 6, 1945, we arrived back at New York. And we paid off the ship, and it was a 28-day trip total. So that's pretty short. But it was okay, though. And that was the end of the second trip. Now, we used to hang out by Betty Fishback's house. And around the corner was where the girl I was dating at the time lived. Her name was Lillian. Lillian Berube and Betty Fishback were friends, and they hung out together and went out with some of our guys, so we all were one big clique. And so we all hung out together, Betty, Lillian, a couple of my friends. We went out to different places, you know, we would date. We would all meet there on 23rd Street in Coney Island, right off Neptune Avenue. That was a kind of like a meeting place for us, like a hangout, you know. We all met there when we were going any place that night. That was our prime spot to hang out, the backyard. That was it. Now, at this time, the World War II in Europe with Germany was ended when we came home on this T2 tanker. And now the war in the Pacific with Japan was still raging, full blast. So that my next trip takes me to the Pacific Ocean, where the war was still going on. Okay? On June 16, 1945, for my third trip, I boarded the SS John Wise, which is a Liberty ship, bound for the Pacific Ocean. So on this trip, Bob Kowalski and I went to the Union Hall and we shipped out together and got on the same ship. And of course, this was my second trip with Bob Kowalski. And when we departed New York, we sailed south down the coast, around the tip of Florida, and we had to pass close by the coast of Miami Beach for the first time. Somebody told me, if you want to get your letter off, we'll be passing a mail buoy. So I thought they were kidding me. I thought it was a joke, you know, because when you're a new guy on the ship, they pull tricks like that on you. I really didn't believe that you could actually mail a letter while you were sailing past Miami. But then I asked around about it, and they said, yes, it was true. So I quickly wrote a letter as fast as I could, sealed it and put a stamp on it, and put it in a bottle and added a flag. I did the whole thing up and then threw it over the side. And then somebody with a fishing boat would come by and pick it up, and it would get mailed. They would mail it for you. So that was an interesting thing to do. And there's always fishing boats out there. So it was customary for people going by to put a note in a bottle and add a flag to it and throw it over the side, and then the fishing boats would pick it up and then they would take it into town and mail your letter, so your letter would be postmarked Miami Beach. And so even though you didn't stop there, you just went by, but you got a letter off. So it was like, it's kind of interesting that they used to do that then. Well, I could tell you, I don't remember. Probably home. Probably the letter was I probably mailed the letter home to Brooklyn, West 6th Street. And then we went over to Panama. And we entered the canal and through the first set of locks. You see the locks when you come into the canal, and the ship sails into the lock, and they close up the gate behind you, and they fill it up with water, and that's how they raise the ship up. And then you go to another lock, and they do the same thing, and they fill it up with water, and it raises the ship up. That's how you get from one level to another. They close the lock behind you, and then they fill it up with water. And that's how the locks work. Then you go through Gatun Lake, and you sail across the whole Isthmus of Panama. It's called the Isthmus of Panama. And next, you pass through the Calibre Cut. I was fortunate to be on the wheel. And the Calibre Cut is where they cut through the rocks. They blasted through the rocks in order to make the passage for the ship to go through there. That's what the Calibre Cut is. They cut through the rocks like a mountain. When you're going through, it's so close that you feel that you can reach out and touch the wall as the ship is passing by, that close. After you get through Calibre Cut, you come out at the Pacific side. Now you have to go through a set of locks to enter the Pacific. But now that we're in the Pacific Ocean, and the danger is the Japanese have submarines and they're patrolling around. And we were traveling, not in convoy, but alone, and we had to steer a zigzag course across all the way to Manus Island in order to prevent them from able to aim the torpedoes and hit the ship As long as we were not going in a straight line, it would be difficult for them to do that. And so for 35 days, we steered a zigzag course to Manus Island. On this trip, we had deck cargo on the hatches from forward to aft. And it was a fighter plane, an aircraft fighter plane, and it was called the Vostokovsky F-4U. With the gull wings. Yeah, the wings folded up, see, like that, you know. And then they were next to each other on the hatches. They were just, the decks were clear to walk on, but the hatches was where they piled the planes up. They put two or three planes on each hatch. Of course, the hatches are all different sizes. So number one, number two, and then number three is a big hatch. So they held different amounts on deck. Well, it probably was like 15 planes. About 15 planes on deck. So that was our deck cargo. And When we sailed across out in the Pacific from Panama all the way to the Admiralties, it was in the South Pacific, it was very hot. So we slept out on deck at night, and we could sleep under the wings of the plane and be out where it was cool and was a breeze blowing. It was so hot we slept out on the hatch. And that was one good thing about having the planes on deck, that we had some place to sleep under. Yeah. All right, when we got to Manus Island and we unloaded all our supplies, we had a lot of PX supplies like beer and soda and wine and candy and cookies and cakes and things like that. And Manus Island happens to be the place where General MacArthur walked ashore. When he told everybody when he had to evacuate on a PT boat, he vowed that he would be back. And this is where he came. When he came back to fight the Japanese, he landed on Manus Island and he stepped out of the landing barge and walked right into the water with his shoes and his pants on and his other aids. And that's how they got back to Manus Island. That was where they landed, right there in that spot. And MacArthur said, I shall return. That's, and then he kept his promise that he did return. Yeah, well, Manus Island was a big supply depot where they brought supplies from all over and unloaded them there. And then other ships came in, would resupply themselves at Manus Island. And there was a big group of CBs. Now, CBs were mostly construction people that worked in the construction, building the airfields and things like that, and barracks. So they were construction guys. And they were sort of like the Merchant Marine. They were almost civilians, but they were also in the service. And so because all the different services came in there, the English and the Americans and the Navy, the Army, the Marines, there was all different types of soldiers and sailors in there. All the different ships pulled in, get their supplies, and then went back out again. And so Manus Island was a big supply depot, and they had soccer fields because the English were there, and they played soccer, they played football, they played baseball, and at night, once it was dark, they showed movies outdoors. The screen was on in the outdoors, and we just sit on benches and watch all the whatever movies they had to show. So that was a recreation for the nighttime. It was pretty nice, though. Just sitting on benches in the jungle. You know, there was no theater. There was just a screen up. And While the movie was going on, when there was a break in it somewhere, a Catholic priest, who also was an officer, got up on the stage and announced that we had just dropped an atomic bomb on Japan. And we were hearing this, and none of us knew what an atomic bomb was, or what it could do, or what it looked like, or anything. He tried to explain to us just how powerful it was, and it was a new thing that, you know, came to be. And that was the first atom bomb that was dropped there. And then, of course, they dropped another one a couple of days later. But the Japanese didn't surrender when they dropped the first one. So when they dropped the second one, they thought, well, I guess they really mean business, so they surrendered. So that was the end of the Second World War, called VJ Day. It stands for Victory in Japan. All right, so when we left Manus Island, and our destination was San Francisco, and we carried mail, and we had a few servicemen that were let out of the hospital because they were wounded and sick, and so they put them on our ship as transportation back to the States. And as we entered San Francisco, it just happened that my wheel watch came up just before we went under the bridge, so that I was fortunate to be on the wheel on the bridge as we passed right under the Golden Gate Bridge, which was the first time I had ever been there anyway. So that was quite an exciting honor. All right, we pulled into the dock in San Francisco where we unloaded the mail that we brought back. This mail was all from service people over there. And we also took off a few passengers that were all service people and got rid of them. And then they put us out at anchor out of the stream again. And when we wanted to go ashore, we would have to go up on a wheelhouse and blow the ship's whistle. And then the launches that were running around the harbor, they had these water taxis running from ship to ship. And you blew the whistle and a water taxi would come over and pick you up and take you into the dock, and you would go ashore in San Francisco. That's the way they did it. And when we came back, we had to catch a ferry at the ferry station in San Francisco and a launch that would take us back to our ship when it was time to go back. But they only worked up until a certain time, like midnight. And after midnight, there was no launches running. So when I missed the launch one time, I had to sleep in the ferry station on a bench till the morning. Because they only ran up to a certain time, and there was not many people after midnight, so they would just cut out the launches. And they just ran during the day, mostly. So when I missed the last launch, I had to sleep in the ferry station in San Francisco. I don't remember Bob Kowalski being with me. I just remember being by myself. He might have left early and went back, and I got stuck and missed the last boat. So I got stuck sleeping in the ferry station. That was a good experience for me. We paid off the ship September 23rd. 1945, and we got a hotel room. We were lucky to get a hotel room because we were considered service, and so we had priority. So when we went up to the USO, they had rooms set aside for servicemen, because San Francisco was so crowded with people because the war ended and all these soldiers and sailors were coming back, and their families and their wives and families would get on a train and go to San Francisco or Los Angeles, wherever the ships were coming in, and the soldiers and sailors were coming back from the war, so they were going there to meet them, and there was no hotel rooms to to be had. We stayed there 2 weeks, and then we had to use our priority ticket to get on a train going to Los Angeles. I was going to go visit my sister who lived in Los Angeles. It was a 500-mile trip, but we had to wait for our turn to get passage on the train. Even that was crowded also. The way it was jammed up. The city was really crowded, you know. When we got on the train, the train was crowded, and we had our suitcases and sea bags with us, and there was no place to keep them but just right on the floor between the seats. And so the train was so overcrowded, everybody was carrying everything they could carry, and it took us 12 hours to go from San Francisco to Los Angeles because the train stopped everywhere along the way. There was no express about it, and it had to stop and pick up stuff and drop off stuff, and people got on and people got off, and they put more people on the train than there was seats. So people were standing up, like on a busy subway train, or sitting on the floor. We were sitting on our sea bags, but we gave up our seat to somebody else. And we didn't have a seat all the way there for 12 hours. We sat on our sea bags on the floor. And that's the way it was at that time, you know? Anyway, when I got to L.A., staying at my sister's house, I found out that my two nephews, Buddy and Junior, had built a coop and were flying pigeons like we used to do in New York, in Coney Island. But Buddy was away in the army, and Junior was neglecting the birds. He was just feeding them and giving them water. So they hadn't gotten out to fly for so long that they forgot how to fly. They lose their wings. You know, well, we didn't want them to become what we call rats, because when they don't fly and they're stuck on the ground, they act like they really can't use their wings. They lose their muscle power and everything. So I let them out, and they wouldn't go up any place. But I did that every day until they finally started flying, and then I had to flock. At a certain time of the day, in the afternoon, they would go up and all fly around together. And if a stray came by, I was able to catch a stray and bring him back down to the coop. So I took over flying the birds and taking care of them. It was very nice. And of course, we were free to go around. We had nothing else to do. So at night, I would drive my brother-in-law, Angelo, to his job at the bakery. And then we would come home, and then in the morning we would pick him up and bring him back home, and he would go to sleep because he slept during the day. And I would drive Junior to high school, and then I would drive my niece Betty and pick up a couple of her girlfriends. They were enrolled in college at the time. And then Bob and I, my friend Bob Kowalski, and I would then go over to Griffin Park, which is where everybody goes horseback riding. There's stables all around there. Well, when we left the stable, we actually had to cross the Los Angeles River. But the Los Angeles River at that time was just a little trickle running in the bottom. Yeah, the stable was on one side of the river, and Griffith Park was on the other side of the river. So you had to cross the river. You went down one side. It was very wide and very deep. You had a walkway. You went down one side, and you walked across. There was 2 or 3 inches of water just flowing in the bottom of the river. And you would walk through that, and then you'd go up the other side. And then you were in the park, in Griffith Park. You could ride up in the hills and enjoy yourself, you know, just taking yourself a nice ride. We would go up there for 2 or 3 hours. We would do that almost every day, to horseback riding. It wasn't too expensive at that time. And we would rent horses and ride the trails up in Griffith Park. where we would, by the way, see a lot of stars. Like we saw Alan Ladd and his wife riding on a bridle path. We saw Cecil B. DeMille riding his big horse on a bridle path. And all these movie cowboys would be out there with their horses also riding around. So we always see famous people there in Griffith Park. They all work in Hollywood. So that was very interesting. And we were in L.A. Bob Kowalski was with me in L.A. at my sister's house. And after we were there 2 or 3 weeks, Bob decided to go down to the Union and ship out. So after Bob left L.A. and shipped out, I stayed back about 3 weeks before I caught a ship. And in the meantime, we went horseback riding some more in Griffith Park. Did all the things that we used to. We flew the pigeons. We kept the pigeons flying and training them. And so that was a whole flock of birds and gave me something to do every day. And going out with Junior and Betty. Betty is my niece and they're friends. And we went out at night. We went over to Hollywood. We did things like that. We toured around town. I borrowed one of their cars and we would drive into L.A. and go over by the TV studios and all and take all that in. That was interesting. So we did all that. That was an afterthought. That's when Betty met her first husband. He was her boyfriend at that time. He was in the Navy. And he was on an aircraft carrier in town by the where they pull in there, San Pedro. And so that's when we got to meet her then boyfriend, who she actually got married to. He was from Oklahoma. By that time, I kind of run out of money and overstayed my leave, is why. And so I had the ship out, because I couldn't just stay there. I couldn't get a job or anything. That was what dictated that I had to ship out. And there was plenty of shipping available, so it was no problem at that time. The only place to get a ship was 30-some-odd miles away from L.A. to San Pedro, where the Union Hall was, and all the ships came in there. That's the Los Angeles Harbor, and it's very busy there. So I did get on a ship that was on Terminal Island. The ship was named the SS Sidney H. Short, which was a Liberty ship run by the Pacific Far East Line. And then the day that I had to sign articles, when the commissioner was going to be there, we all had to sign on, and would drive there and take care of business. That day I was driving to Terminal Island, and the policeman was following me because I was going too fast. I was trying to get there because I was late. And when I pulled up to the gangplank, there he was he pulled up right along. Alongside of me and informed me that I was speeding and I was going to have to get a ticket. So I had to tell him that you'll have to just wait a minute because the commission is on the ship and I have to sign articles. They have to run on board and take care of that. So I went up the gangplank, went into the saloon, the officer's mess. The commissioner was there and everybody was signing on, so I signed the articles and then I went back down off the gangplank and the policeman, sure enough, was still waiting there. And he wrote me a ticket and I told him that the ship was leaving the next day and I wouldn't be here to answer the ticket. What should I do about that? But he gave me the ticket anyway. And then the ship left there, and then later on when I wrote to my sister, and she wrote back to me to tell me that a policeman came to the house with a warrant for my arrest because I ran out on that ticket. But I had an excuse. The ship was leaving. I had no choice. I had to leave. And that was, I thought that was pretty funny. Actually, my sister wanted to know what happened. Why were they here with a warrant for your arrest? You know? And so she was the oldest one in the family, my sister Amelia, and I was the youngest one in the family. So that was a story there. I never paid the ticket. November 26th, we went aboard the ship, and December 1st, we signed articles. I went there to get on the ship first, but then I had to go back and sign articles after that. On December 6th, we left San Pedro Harbor, and we went to a port down the coast called Port Hueneme. When we were docked there, it was a very small town on the coast, and everything was Western, and there was no big bars, and there was no big hotels, and they used that docking area, you know, because there were so many ships coming in, they couldn't all get into San Francisco or L.A., so that was one of the ports that they used, like secondary, just some place to dock and put things on and off the ship, you know. Well, yeah, there was not much to do there, so I went horseback riding in Port Hueneme. I just found out where there was a stable, and I don't know if I walked or took a taxi cab to get to it. I don't remember how close it was. But it was a small town, so everything was kind of all together there. Well, I don't remember exactly who, but maybe somebody was, one of the guys might have been with me, and I might have somebody to come along. I don't remember who it was, if there was somebody with me. There might have been somebody. We always traveled together. We went places like a buddy system, you know. We were always with someone, so if we did something, it's usually somebody else was involved with it, too. Yeah, and so we rented a horse and we went horseback riding. And also, we visited Oxnard and Ventura. And December 14th, we left, and we were sailing down the coast of California. On December 18th, we were off Mexico. On the 21st, we were off Acapulco. I should mention that we were sailing along. I remember being on the wheel, in the wheelhouse, and the third mate was a young fella right out of school. And he asked me to give it a little bit left wheel. And so we gave the ship a left wheel, and we sailed in towards the coast. And as we got close to the coast, we could see the houses and the buildings there. And he pointed out that was Acapulco. Then we made a right turn and started back. And I just want to say one thing about Acapulco. Acapulco was on the coast, and the only way to get there was by boat. At that time, nobody used to go to Acapulco unless you had a yacht. People with yachts would sail into Acapulco and hang out there for a while. It was a fun place to be. And they didn't have an airport, and they didn't have trains going there. The only place to get there was if you had a boat and you could sail into it. And you, no big ships could pull in there. And people like Errol Flynn used to go down with his yacht and bring his girlfriends down there. And if anybody was lucky enough to get to Acapulco, they said that you would get a girl with every beer. On the 22nd, we were off Guatemala. On the 23rd, it was Honduras. On the 24th, we were off Nicaragua and Costa Rica. On the 26th, it was Balboa, Panama City, Diablo. Well, Balboa and Panama City is where you enter the canal. And we came into Panama, and we tied up, and then we went ashore in Panama City, and it happened to be New Year's Eve. And so all the bars and nightclubs were open, and there were full people, and the waiters were running around, and the music was playing. It was a really wild time, the wildest I ever saw any place. They really celebrate New Year's over there like there's no tomorrow, you know. And they broke bottles and sprayed champagne, and the police came in to arrest them. And the Panama police are mostly little guys with big clubs. They have the biggest clubs you ever saw, and they weren't afraid to use them. So anyway, we finally got out of there, and without getting beat up or anything, or getting involved in getting arrested. Some of the guys did get arrested, but I didn't. But it was the wildest time I ever saw any place for New Year's. On January 5th, we went through the canal and tied up in Cristobal. When we walked around during the day, in the daylight, we just toured around. We went over by the waterfront, and we discovered an old fort that was still there with the wall up and the cannons sticking out. The guns were facing the water, protect them from any invaders that might come in there at the time. And it was back from the days of the sailing ships coming through there. So it was nice to visit this old fort and walk around by the waterfront. On January 8th, we left Cristobal. January 11th, San Antonio, Cuba is sighted from 11 miles away. January 14th, 1:30 a.m., we arrived in Galveston, and we were hanging off the ship, and we were getting ready to make a dramatic departure back to New York. We were going to fly. One of the pilots came aboard our ship and just asked around, who's going to New York, because we have a plane ready if anybody wants a flight. So we thought that was terrific, that, boy, we're going to get flight on a plane. We don't even have to go down to the airport and pay for the ticket, you know. Then he had the taxi cab. When he got a bunch of guys lined up for a full flight, he had the taxi cabs all come to the dock. And we loaded all our sea bags and stuff into the cabs, and he drove us out to the airport. And there was this little airport with weeds growing up through the cracks in the cement, because they used to use that during the war for training pilots. It was an auxiliary airport. It didn't have big buildings all over it, you know. It had a little windsock. So we got to the airport in this whole bunch of cabs, and we got out. We were standing there with our whole pile of baggage on the runway, and a plane, a two-engine plane that used to be a paratrooper plane, lands on the airport and pulls up to where we are. And then we all loaded our bags in there, and the guys were all drinking. They were having a drink before they got on the plane. And so some of them got kind of woozy. In fact, they were a little drunk. So the pilot says, he says, all right, you sober guys get on there first. He was talking to the drunks. So they would get on first with their bags. And they were just laughing. Everybody was having a ball. So we got on this plane, and we find out there's just the metal seats on either side of the plane where the paratroopers would sit. There was no regular soft seats, and the plane was not insulated inside. There were just the ribs of the body you could see. And then he got us all in there, and then he was waiting for his relief to come. He was supposed to leave the plane there, and somebody was supposed to show up. So the gasoline truck comes alongside, and the pilot grabs grabs the hose, runs up on the wing, starts gassing up the plane, because that's where the tanks are in the wing, and imagine, he just got through flying it there, now he's gassing up the plane, and then he's looking around, and his relief was not showing up, so he was going to get in the plane and take off again. And then this convertible comes racing onto the field. That was his relief, and so he jumped out of the car, jumped into the plane, and the guy in the plane jumped out and went in the car and took off. And he took off, just one pilot, no co-pilot, just one guy flying the plane. And he took off from there, and the next stop, he landed in New Orleans. And he landed in New Orleans for a little while, and then took off from there, and the next stop was Newark, New Jersey. The pilots of the plane were from the Flying Tigers when the war was over, and they came back, and they needed work, and they wanted work, and that's how they got it. They bought the old paratrooper planes, and they called the airline the Flying Tigers. And all the while on that plane, we froze, because there was no heat, there was no air conditioning, and it was drafty. The wind was blowing through the plane, so we were sitting on the floor on our bags, trying to get cozy. And it was a bumpy trip, really, and freezing cold. And who else would fly on a plane like that except a bunch of dopey sailors? We were happy to get a flight just like that. It was convenient, but it was not comfortable at all. But it wasn't expensive either, it was cheap. I don't remember exactly how much it was, but I remember that it was cheaper than if you would go to the airport and try to take a regular flight. And they picked us up from the ship and drove us right to the airport. And this was an airport that was never used for commercial flights. It was an old abandoned Army Air Training Center, and that was it. So then we were back at Newark, and we were home again. I have no memory of how he actually got from Newark to Coney Island. Well, I told you I don't remember how we don't remember if we went by train or by bus or by taxi cab or if someone drove over to Newark and picked us up with a car. That's a blank spot somewhere. Yeah, well, to be a merchant marine during the war was very important. We carried the troops over and we carried supplies to each and every place. And that was our job, and we just did it. Well, what else can you say?
Over the sea, let's go, men. We're shoving right off again. Nobody knows where or when. We're shoving right off again. It may be Shanghai, farewell and goodbye. Sally and Sue, don't be blue. We've just begun for years and years and then. We're shoving right off for home, shoving right off for home. Sailing away, we're sailing away again.
Nobody knows where or when.
We're sailing away, we're sailing away again.
It may be Shanghai. Farewell.
merchant marine, and we sail across the sea. As the U-boat torpedoes hunt for hulls that they can breach, we will brave the rugged ocean, blistering winds, test out of ocean, but we'll keep steaming till our cargo's on the beach. We arrived in Halifax with all we owned upon our backs, for we knew a brave man's duty was to labor for the fight. But it takes more than bravery to survive killers you can't see. Those bastard wolf packs hunt by day and strike by night. We have barely any weapons. Every day our lives are threatened, and if we die, the Navy sends no pension to our wives. Winter on the North Atlantic is hellish cold and frantic, for the sea alone's a challenge to survive. We're the merchant marine, and we sail across the sea. As the U-boat's torpedoes hunt for hulls that they can breach, we will brave the rugged ocean, blistering winds, test out of ocean, but we'll keep steaming till our cargo's on the beach. In the war of Hitler's visions, the Allies would get no provisions. Total war was his decision, sinking ships not built to fight. The finest liners of our day are now painted battle grey, but the two small guns they mounted caused no fright. Now it's true we had protection, two destroyers in our section, three frigates, two corvettes to shepherd 50 through the waves. But one destroyer's now debris, both corvettes lost under the sea, and our sister ship's an underwater grave. We're the merchant marine, and we sail across the sea. As the U-boat's torpedoes hunt for hulls that they can breach, we will brave the rugged ocean, blistering winds, test out of ocean, but we'll keep steaming till our cargo's on the beach. Now we mourn our fallen brothers, pray to God there'll be no others, blown to bits by diving demons deep below. For the carnage and the thunder that sucked those good boys under happens daily, and we've three more days to go. We're the merchant marine, and we sail across the sea. As the U-boat's torpedoes hunt for hulls that they can breach, we will brave the rugged ocean, blistering winds, the start of ocean, but we'll keep steaming till our cargo's on the beach. We're the merchant marine, and we sail across the sea. As the U-boat's torpedoes hunt for hulls that they can breach, we will brave the rugged ocean, blistering winds, test out of ocean, but we'll keep steaming till our cargo's on the beach. Yes, we'll keep steaming till our cargo's on the beach.